machines can't think as people do. The machine is different.
So as you can see from this first slide, I'm going to talk about how in real life, animals can sometimes act a lot like people. So I'm at Western Washington University in the Department of Psychology in the Behavioral Neuroscience program. And so this talk is going to be a bit of a compilation of some of my favorite social media videos showing animals acting like humans, or humanizing animals, I guess. And then I'm going to conclude with some laboratory research to show you how we're addressing this question of human qualities or human type qualities in animals. So I don't think it's a very big surprise when you talk to, say, pet owners that animals seem to have these traits and personalities. So if you talk to a pet owner about their fur baby, for instance, they will tell you all of their sort of little quirks and idiosyncrasies. But as a neuroscientist, I'm interested in the connection between behavior and the underlying signaling and mechanisms of brain cells and neurons. So let me show you. There we go. So in behavioral neuroscience, we take some kind of behavior. So what's that's supposed to depict is, obviously, this is a child or a baby and all the different types of behaviors that they can perform. And we're trying to connect those behaviors to some kind of functioning in the brain or some signaling between neurons. And so in order to pinpoint those behaviors, we really have to describe the behavior well in order to understand what's happening at the level of the brain. And we also have to understand the brain very well in order to describe how it accounts and can be affecting behavior. So one of the most well-known instances of laboratory behavior testing, of course, would have been Pavlov. I assume you all knew that, okay? And he, of course, just a quick refresher, is that he noticed in a totally unrelated experiment, of course, that dogs would salivate in anticipation of food, but they would salivate in response to a signal that would say that the food was about to arrive. So whether that was a bell ringing, that was Pavlov operationalizing it, or even just the arrival of the researcher, there was this sort of anticipatory salivation that would happen. And then, of course, that preparatory salivation would be reinforced by the eventual occurrence of food or delivery of food. So Pavlov was providing the reinforcer, and the dog was, of course, performing the behavior. But as you can see, the nature of this cartoon, it could have been, the dog could have had its own motivation or sort of like an ulterior motive in that, look what I can do. This is what the human does when I do this. And when I think about that, how many times I've had pets condition me to do things like, oh, now you need to go outside because you're jumping up on me, or now it's time to feed you because you're jumping into my lap. So little things like that made me think, oh, you know, we shouldn't really think that these animals are just these reactive, responsive organisms and that we are sort of commanding everything. In fact, we could be responding to them. They could be training us, is a way to think of it. So the first of this social media compilation is this example. I think it's been going around quite a bit. Maybe some of you have seen it. And we're not going to watch the whole thing because it's kind of a long video. But it has to do with, a guy who obviously rescues a dog at a shelter. Get the volume going here.
In 2010, my doctor told me to buy a funeral plot because I would need one within the next 5 years. But I'm still here because a shelter dog saved my life. When people see a photo of who I was 5 years ago, they can't and often don't believe that it's me. My weight had crept up to 340 pounds. My blood pressure was through the roof, super high cholesterol. I had type 2 diabetes and I was taking over $1,000 worth of medications a month. And I just felt really uncomfortable around other people. I became separated from society and I just stopped living. I went on a business trip. You know how small airplane seats are? I could barely squeeze into one and basically I'd spill over both sides. They had to delay the flight because they didn't have a seatbelt extension that would fit me. There was a gentleman next to me and he just looked in complete disgust and he looked at me and he goes, "I'm going to miss my connection because you're too fat." That really was my my bottom point. That's the point that I really decided that, you know, I'm either going to die or I have to do something. I looked in the phone book and I found a nutritionist near me. One of the first things that she asked me to do was to go adopt a shelter dog. It would force me to go outside. It would force me to become more socially interactive. So I went to the local shelter. And I remember telling the lady I would like an obese, middle-aged dog so that I would have something in common with him. And when I walked into the room, we both looked at each other with like a look of, really? I took him home that night. Neither of us knew what to expect. And over a period of time, we really formed an inseparable bond and one that I'd never really experienced with another person or animal or anybody. We began walking for at least a half an hour a day, every day, and over the course of a year, just by changing what I ate and walking with Petey, I lost about 140 plus pounds. Everything about my life improved. I got off all meds. I no longer have type 2 diabetes. Petey also lost about 25 pounds, so we did it together. It was like a miracle.
There you go. Ooh, hi, Petey.
So I read over Petey's paperwork when I adopted him, and it turns out that he was left alone in a backyard, and nobody played with him. He'd had arthritis and all kinds of rashes, and his skin was just itching all the time. He was wondering what would ever happen to him. He'd gone from being in a situation like I was, where he didn't have any friends and he didn't know anybody, and really became a proud dog.
Petey ready for the next stop? Petey's a good boy.
Beyond unconditional love.
Yum, peanut butter.
Petey taught me absolute loyalty. He looked at me in every sense as though I was the greatest person on the planet. I decided that I wanted to be the person who he thought I was.
Okay, so I won't play the whole thing. You can probably find it on YouTube. But I just want to ask you, because when I watched this movie, sure, Eric became a runner. But who was providing the positive reinforcement for his behavior? Yeah. Hand up. Yeah? The dog. Yeah, of course. Petey had a big task too, right? That was a big challenge for Petey to get this owner who'd never had a dog before out walking on a regular basis and then finally running, and he does become a marathon runner in the end, and Petey is along this entire ride. So it's this other perspective of, sure, he made the decision to go adopt this dog, and they were both in this situation of, I don't know how to do this, but Petey trained him fairly well to go out, get exercise, and this man, of course, reaped a lot of positive benefits as a result, and actually now that Petey's passed, sorry to let you know about that. he has adopted a second dog. Just okay, so getting back to Pavlov for a second here. So for decades prior to Pavlov's big experiment and since the time of Pavlov's experiment, we've been doing a lot of work to try to define what distinguishes humans from animals. What is our sort of humanness that animals don't really exhibit, at least as much. And there are a lot of very eloquent explanations of this and a lot of research. It's worth the Google search if you have the time. One of the most famous philosophers who weighed in on this, and this is going back a few centuries, is, of course, Descartes. So I'm not going to go into a big philosophical. It's not my area of expertise, per se, but I always have to talk about Descartes. So 1596 to 1650, and his idea was that unlike animals, humans have this additional connection. So you can see here, this is the input from the environment, this is what we share with animals. And then humans also have this added connection to, at the time, Descartes thought it was something to do with a connection to spirituality or to a god, and that's where our very commanding cognitive ideas come from. So you can see the idea, point at it, is being told to this human via some outside source, and then the person points, and then that affects, of course, the information coming in through the senses. And it's the information coming in through the senses that we have in common with animals, but it's the idea to actually initiate the pointing action that we is where we differ from animals, according to Descartes. More recently, others have described that the limitations of other creatures on the planet outside of humans is that they can't interpret the belief of others. And so that might be oversimplifying the idea a bit and maybe losing something in the meaning, but when I Google searched what are true human traits, I eventually found this list from an author, Tom Robbins. Yeah. Oh, there, Cartesian dualism, right? The dualism of the signal from the higher self versus animal self. Tom Robbins, of course, I think is best known for Fierce Invalids Home from Hot Climates. Yeah, really some awesome reading. Okay, so 6 qualities that make us fully human, though. Here's the list. So for number 1 being humor. And many of you probably have seen this video. It has come across my social media pages quite frequently. But here is an orangutan, and he's going to observe a magic trick, and he's going to think it's hilarious. I've totally just given away the whole gist of this video, but yet it's still surprising.
Crazy guy.
So there's an example of an animal having a humorous moment, appreciating magic and responding with humor, or laughing anyway. The second point was imagination, and I thought that would be something really hard to find a video for, so I didn't even bother. The third being eroticism, and I'm going to leave that in the same place as imagination. If you ever Google animal eroticism... Your name will definitely end up on a list somewhere. Okay, so. But the last two listed on his 6 were rebelliousness and beauty. And so regarding beauty, I could show you a number of pictures from nature that are, of course, beautiful. The one that I picked is actually from a scanning electron microscope picture. It's actually the head of a flea. Beautiful, right? It's colorized. They're not really that color in real life. Or maybe it's the appreciation of beauty that is more of the human trait, and obviously in nature, frequently it's the males that are more colorful, so it would have to be the females are appreciating their beauty. But with rebelliousness, if you Google rebellious animals, okay, this comes up, which is another great animated movie with political undertones. If you haven't seen it, it's always a good one to watch. But if we describe rebelliousness as animals performing or taking on a role that's different from the one that they were intended to have, right? So what I'm saying is something similar to if you became an artist, but you were from a family of lawyers, right? People want you to be a lawyer, but you become an artist. That might be a way to describe rebelliousness. And interestingly... Rebel baboons. In baboons, in certain subgroups, typically they live in a very strict social hierarchy. So when you are born to a subordinate male or female, you are going to grow up to be also subordinate. But interestingly, about 10% of subordinates actually become dominant and they're not sure why. So they actually show the physical traits. They have the larger red bottom, all of that, of the dominant animals, even though they were born subordinate. So in a way, you could think of that as being rebellious against their intended role. Even though they were born to be subordinate, they became dominant. So an interesting phenomenon that has also occurred with one baboon troop, and luckily a Stanford researcher was observing this, Robert Sapolsky. This is my next video for you guys. This is fascinating because this tells us that even if we're exhibiting, even if an animal, and by extension presumably humans, is exhibiting dominant aggressive behavior, it doesn't mean that they don't have the capacity to be pro-social, compassionate kind.
The Kinkaroc troop is the one I started with 30 years ago. And they were your basic old baboon troop at the time, and which means males were aggressive and society was highly stratified. And then about, by now, almost 20 years ago, something horrific and scientifically very interesting happened to that troop.
The Kinkaroc troop took to foraging for food in the garbage dump of a popular tourist lodge. The trash included meat tainted with tuberculosis. The result was that nearly half the males in the troop died.
In that troop, if you were aggressive, and if you were not particularly socially connected, socially affiliated, you didn't spend your time grooming and hanging out, if you were that kind of male, you died.
Every alpha male was gone. The Kinkaroc troop had been transformed.
And what you were left with was twice as many females as males, and the males who were remaining were, you know, just to use scientific jargon, they were good guys. They were not aggressive jerks. They were nice to the females. They were very socially affiliative. It completely transformed the atmosphere of the troop. And when new adolescent males would join the troop, they'd come in just as jerky as any adolescent males elsewhere on this planet, and it would take them about 6 months to learn, we're not like that in this troop. We don't do stuff like that. We're not that aggressive. We spend more time grooming each other. Males are calmer with each other. You do not dump on a female if you're in a bad mood. And it takes these new guys about 6 months, and they assimilate this style, and you have baboon culture, and this particular troop has a culture of very low levels of aggression and high levels of social affiliation, and they're doing that 20 years later.
So it was a lasting change. Something that was horrific, obviously, having so many of the males die off, actually produced this very affiliative, pro-social culture within this single baboon troop. And to the extent where new males could come along and try to exert their will, if you will, on the rest of the troop, and they would be conditioned to assimilate into this very pro-social culture. So it means that ability is in there, and that the right circumstances to sort of tease it out, I'm sort of setting the stage for later, tease it out needs to occur in order for us to see it. So there's also been an example of interspecies affiliative pro-social behavior in the news recently. Maybe you've seen this one. Jing Jing, the penguin. This penguin migrates like 8,000 miles or something ridiculous just to visit its rescuer and hang out with him in Brazil. So obviously penguins are from the Antarctic.
On the coast of southeast Brazil, a penguin has made himself at home with an unlikely companion. For the last 4 years, this Magellanic penguin has been hanging out with a retired bricklayer named João Pereira de Souza. The penguin, nicknamed Jing Jing, disappears into the ocean for as much as 4 months at a time. But when he comes back, it's always to de Souza's shanty by the sea. De Souza found Jing Jing in 2011, soaked in oil and lying on the beach in front of his house. He fed the bird some sardines and gave it a shady spot to rest, and he hasn't been able to get rid of Jing Jing since. Magellanic penguins are known for migrating thousands of miles a year between breeding colonies in Patagonia and feeding grounds further north. Despite their reputation as cold water animals, the birds have been known to turn up in the warm waters of Brazil, where a northbound current occasionally drops them off on tropical beaches like this one in Rio de Janeiro state. But local fishermen have never seen anything like this.
The funniest thing is that the penguin might stay here for a week. Then it walks down to the beach and leaves. It spends 10, 12, 15 days, and then comes back to the same house. They're supposed to join together, find some path to the south, but he doesn't.
Jingjing regularly goes to sea for days, weeks, or months at a time, only to waddle his way back to Mr. D'Souza's home. He usually spends about 8 months of the year here, and the bond between the two has become pretty strong. D'Souza says Jingjing won't allow other animals to get anywhere close to him.
So the fact that he's commuting that far just to visit this rescuer really indicates that he's exhibiting some real pro-social behavior. So if we go back to our list of our six qualities that make us fully human, nothing official, remember, Tom Robbins, we could perhaps add something that manifests out of kindness or empathy, something that is produced from those dispositions, something like altruism. Right? So if we think, we always have this idea that animals are working towards their own survival, and that that is the sort of chief determinant of the behavior that they're going to exhibit. But if we can demonstrate animals also have programming, circuitry, signaling that allows them to behave altruistically to one another, then it really starts to muddy the waters in terms of the extent that we are humans and separate from animals around us. So obviously altruism, for those who haven't heard the word yet, younger in the crowd maybe, think about a firefighter. It's altruistic. It's from altruism that a firefighter would go into a burning building to rescue a family or a stranger or a dog even. And so do animals also display this level of maybe selflessness and kindness towards each other? Maybe you've seen, I'm not going to show you the video because the video is too long and has a lot of ideas about it. But Shooter the elk, he's in a zoo in Idaho, and what they noticed Shooter doing one day was spending a lot of time around his watering hole, his trough there, and he was really interested in something that was in the water, and so he spent something like 15 minutes around this watering hole, and he was sort of getting his hoof in there and his antlers and sort of stirring up the water. And finally, what happened, here he is stirring it up, he finally pulls out, there's something in his mouth there. I'll give you a better view of that in a second. There's something in his mouth. It's a little marmot. It's actually his neighbor in the zoo. So he saved his marmot from drowning. They call him the lifeguard elk. And it's interesting because when he took the marmot out of the drinking trough, put the marmot on the ground, and then kind of like did this rudimentary CPR, like kind of nudged him, like, wake up, it's okay. Didn't stomp on him, didn't, you know, eek, mouse, nothing like that. He just sort of revived him in that way by providing that stimulation. And so this is interesting because obviously a marmot is a different species from the elk. They're obviously not related. This is strictly what we would define as altruistic behavior. But can we replicate altruism in the lab? Well, for a long time, we know that rats are excellent mothers. And this in itself is altruistic, because when you think about a rat, in terms of motherhood, they're very good mothers. They lick their pups. They lick their pups excessively. And the more that they lick them, actually, is correlated with a decrease in measurable stress in the pups. And why would you care about that research? Well, it's from understanding that behavior that they discovered that that decrease in measurable stress is actually passed on to the pups and the next generation, and was actually part of the basic research that led to the discovery of how our environment changes the expression pattern of our genes, something called epigenetics. So now this seems a little... why it's altruistic for them to do this is because rats can breed several times in a year, and they have litters. So they can produce hundreds, maybe thousands of pups over their lifetime. And so to actually dedicate that much time and resources to every single pup would seem like, I don't want to say a waste of time, but it would potentially affect the survival or the ongoing survival of the mother. So it doesn't add up why they would do that. Now, the other thing about rat moms is that if they that they are willing to risk danger for these pups, even though they are producing hundreds or thousands of them. So all of their pups, they value all of them, even though that there's many of them. And one of the sort of classic studies from a long time ago actually had the pups removed just a short distance so the mom could see, and then measured how many times she would travel to gather the pups. So one by one, bring them back to where she was standing. Now, she would do that for every pup, whether or not the space between her and the pups was electrified. So notice this. In this graph, in the open circles, that's how many times she would cross that space in a control condition. But if she had to cross that space and that space was electrified, she would actually cross it just as many times. No significant change. Meaning that the rat, even though it produces lots and lots of babies, will dedicate many resources and risk danger to ensure the survival of all of them. Notice also that over the course of several days, the number of times she crosses decreases. It's not because she values them any less. It's because she realizes they're only gone for 10 minutes. If I wait this out, then they're going to return the pups to me, and I can stop crossing this. She learns. She's like, oh, this is a lot. More recently, this is 1986, I think. So more recently, Peggy Mason's lab at University of Chicago has demonstrated, she operationalized this altruistic behavior and looked at, can rats do that to their peers? So it makes sense that a mother rat would want to risk danger if at an evolutionary level in order to ensure the survival of her pups and increase the likelihood that her pups will survive in order to have pups of their own, et cetera, et cetera. There's a evolutionary survival mechanism at work there. But will rats also demonstrate that altruistic behavior if it's a cage mate or a peer, if you will? So what they did is, what you'll see is one of these rats, the one without the dot, is going to be put in this little plexiglass container for a few minutes. And it's uncomfortable for them because they don't like not being able to move around. They're not in it very long, okay? So it's not like actually stressful, it's like mild stress. And what you're gonna see is the behavior of this rat. So this rat is on the outside. So if these two are competitors, you would expect the outside rat to just let that guy in the cylinder stay in the cylinder. But in fact, what this rat will do,
new research shows that rats will liberate each other from a trap even when they get no extra reward for doing so. The animals seem to be showing empathy, which has often been considered unique to primates. In a study published in Science, Inbal Ben-Ami Bartal of the University of Chicago and colleagues report that most rats learned to quickly open a container holding a distressed cage mate. The rats didn't open containers that were empty or that held other objects, but they did free other rats even when they weren't allowed to socialize with them afterwards. And when the researchers placed a handful of chocolate chips nearby, which the free rats could have eaten by themselves, the rats still released their trapped cage mates and shared the chocolate with them.
So if it was an object in the cage, if it was even something fluffy that looked like a rat but wasn't a rat in the cage, the rescuer rat wouldn't open the cage. Even if they had the choice between the chocolate versus opening the cage for the cage mate, they would opt to rescue over chocolate. That's saying something, right? Chocolate? Come on. But some other interesting results from this study have come to light since then. So this is about 2011, and other researchers have looked into this phenomenon. And not only will they do this instead of chocolate, but they will do it, there's a learning curve. So as soon as they learn how to release them from the cage, they do it faster and better every time. So they become really good at it. They'll also do it, so this is with a cage mate, which means that they know each other, they've had frequent encounters, they're usually housed together, but they will also do it for stranger rats. So rats that they've never encountered before, they will also try to free from this cage. And interesting, rats that have been in the cage in the beginning are faster and better at rescuing others. So if you have been the one that has been compromised in the past, you're more likely to be a rescuer in the future. That seems to play out in this assay. So it seems that as testing becomes more sophisticated, we're seeing that indeed animals perhaps do have a sense of others, or community even, and will act to address others' needs, suggesting that pro-social behavior is perhaps the norm across several species. In fact, even in my own laboratory, we've demonstrated a certain pro-socialness of behavior. Now, let me show you what we work on. So the title's at the top. This is the name of our species that we work on. It's a type of worm, Caenorhabditis elegans, or C. elegans for short. It's a microscopic worm. From head to tail, it measures about a millimeter. So all of this is done under a microscope. Very nice, very elegant sinusoidal wave patterns. And we use this model for several reasons. It is comprised of 959 somatic cells. The genome is mapped and sequenced. It was actually the pilot project for the human genome sequencing project. The cell lineage is determined, and so for those of you who don't know what that means every cell division that takes place from the time fertilization occurs, it has been described. So not only do we know all 959 cells in the organism, but we know where they came from, too. And of greatest interest to my research is that the nervous system is made up of a whopping 302 neurons. So obviously, 302 neurons that we can identify by name. We know their connections, how the circuits are lined up, what they use as to signal to one another. And so with such a well-described system, if we can characterize a behavior, then we can expand to understand the mechanism, because we can start to piece together which neurons are involved in that behavior, how their signaling in that circuitry changes as a result of performing the behavior, and if we fiddle with the circuitry, how does that affect the behavior? So using this model, we decided to, it wasn't my idea. And this is really a good example of where your research can go when you're sort of open to the ideas of the undergraduate students coming into your lab. So very early on in my career at Western Washington University, I had an very bright undergraduate student come to me, and he had been working with the worms for several months to this point, and said, I want to look at peer pressure in the worm. And I was like, what did I do to deserve this? So I thought, okay, well, I mean, I don't even know if they can tell each other apart. I don't know if they're like, hey, Frank, hey, Harry, how's it going? Let alone if being able to recognize if one of them's a bully, right? So now I'm like, okay, I don't know how we're going to do this. But we finally devised a way to test this behaviorally. And so we used this assay. We took advantage of the fact that they are, when they're attracted to something, they will move towards it. Very simple behavior, right? I like that. I'm going to go towards that. And so here's the laboratory environment that they exist on. So food, it's a E. coli on a petri dish. And that's kind of how they sort of swim in around that. They distribute themselves on this sort of field of food. But if you put something on one side that they really, really like, so in the case of this experiment, it was a high concentration of sodium chloride, so a high concentration of salt at one side, they really, really like that. And what you'll notice is they start to do this, where they start to migrate towards the area where there's that high concentration of salt. So then we decided, okay, let's give them a challenge where we're going to pit this desire for high salt against staying with a group. So what we needed, of course, was a group of worms that wouldn't detect the salt, which, of course, because this is a well-described biological and genetic system, we could find a number of mutant strains that were insensitive to sodium chloride or didn't detect salt, basically. And so we took that strain, and then in that group of worms, we planted one wild-type salt-sensing worm. And so it was up to that one worm. Do I stay with this group that isn't migrating towards the salt, or do I go to the salt? Now, you may be asking, how do you identify one worm? Luckily, actually in a place not far from here, over Friday Harbor, geneticists actually extracted the gene from jellyfish that allows them to glow and expressed them in the worm. So here's a video you'll see. So our wild-type worm is actually a glowing worm. Here's what they look like when they glow. Actually, it's a, I'll give you a hint. It's an age-old trick. You anesthetize them, put them into the position you want them in, and then as they come out of the out from under anesthesia, you record them, and then you play it backwards. Oh, I knew I was going to do that. I totally knew it. Then you play it backwards. So this is actually how they started, just to reveal the secrets. Okay. So the wild-type worm is glowing, and it's in a group of worms that aren't detecting sodium. And they're on a plate that has high sodium at one end. And so our job was really to go in and find the glowing worm, right? So where is the glowing worm? And so we took, this is a rough rendition of what the actual, how we divided up the plate into different regions. But this black spot would be where there's high sodium, and then we would look to see how close or far they were from this black spot and gave it an arbitrary number from 1 to 6. And so when worms are surrounded by other worms that aren't moving towards sodium, they actually prefer to hang out with their friends. So they will prefer to hang out with their friends more so than if they, and control in this case, this is non-sensing sodium here. The control is that all of them sense sodium and move towards the plug, towards the high sodium region. So low bar indicates they're moving towards the sodium, and when they're amongst other worms, they don't. And so it says, whatever the signal is that's coming from other worms, that signal is one that they will choose over the preferred sodium chloride, suggesting that even though we can break it down to pheromone signals or other mechanisms that tell us when we're in a group, regardless of whatever what the signaling mechanism is, it's preferred over something that signals food even. So in a way, even worms display these complex behavioral traits. And we can see complex behavioral traits like empathy and altruism. It's reproducible in the lab. Even worms demonstrate that pro-social behavior. So perhaps when we're thinking about how human animals really are, maybe it's true, or maybe it's closer to what Charles Darwin once said, in that humans and animals only differ in degree, not kind. So that concludes my talk. We have about 10 minutes, I would say, for Q&A for anyone who has any questions, or else you can take this time to have a break before the movie starts. So thank you for your time, and I appreciate all of you coming out on such a beautiful day in spring break. Yes?
A lot of information, and this is something that is very interesting to me, about human and other animals. And I find it interesting that you're talking about it in terms of a divide. I can see why we're animals, and I think that's something that is really overlooked, right? We're part of the animal kingdom. And a lot of the examples that you showed, like the orangutan laughing, and, you know, the baboon behavior sort of shows to show that there are things that we tend to prize as a uniquely human thing, and not necessarily so. We just may or may not have the means to measure them.
Yes.
I'm curious about where you think in your research or your studies about where we are on the continuum with other animal life on the planet versus trying to see what makes us divergent from the rest of the animal.
Did everyone hear that? Is that okay?
That makes sense.
No. Yes. So where we are, so I'll repeat what I thought you asked, where I stand in terms of how much we diverge from animals in terms of being human, how unique we are compared to animals. Is that?
Do you look at it as just a continuum, or are you invested in improving something one way or the other, that we either are, that animals are like humans, or that we are not?
So the question about improving, I don't know that I would use the word improving so much as just learning about. And by pursuing from the point of view that we share a lot of behavioral traits, and now that list of behavioral traits that are described is growing in terms of ones that we know that we have versus what we can demonstrate in the lab. And the more that we can demonstrate, using the example of the maternal behavior, we don't know what research is going to result in these big breakthroughs in discovery that change how we think about gene expression or mechanisms or signaling. So in terms of where I see humans, how separate I see them, I would argue that we have almost... back to Descartes, but I hate to throw this in there. There does seem to be this part of our behavior that follows the same rules as the behaviors that we see in animals. So we can't deny that we have that there. But we also seem to have this additional ability as far as we know, right? So and it seems to be connected to communication and this sort of cognitive higher thinking. Totally not my area, but... yeah, I don't think about higher cognition. However, if I was just going to throw something out there, I think we're always limited to what we can detect and measure. A good example being, for instance, bats. And this is a very rudimentary example, but bats, obviously, they use auditory signaling not just for detecting prey, but for communicating between each other. And the decibels of the sounds that they emit are really quite loud. They're like a jet engine. But we can't hear them because we're out of that range. Our ears don't pick it up. So we think we're walking in a quiet night. But if we could hear at that frequency, we would hear the screaming that's going on in the forest near us by the bats. So I do think that as we get better at teasing out these sort of behavioral intricacies, that we're going to see a lot more commonality, but we're always going to have this feeling that there's something distinct from us versus all the other creatures on the planet based on how we've sort of affected our planet as a single species. Yeah. Any other questions? Yes?
It seems like you'll see in certain people, humans, for instance, some people are open to animals in a way, like you'll see people come up to a dog and they'll go like, hi dog, and they just totally objectify it as a dog, so they don't feel like there's any ability to communicate with it on a more subtle level. And then there's people that are, they'll actually like connect with the dog. Do you think that goes both ways? There's like dogs that are more open to a more empathetic and one-to-one intuitive relationship with people, almost like a little more higher developed as far as their ability to...
Yeah. Well, okay, so I'm going to talk totally not as a scientist here, but but I do think dogs are better at detecting things that we aren't aware of. So, for instance, if we're putting off some kind of signal, whether it's something that they're smelling or just something in our energy, if you will, like the way we're moving or something like that, I think dogs are very honest in what they're perceiving. They're not... And that might be what separates us from dogs, is that we can be very dishonest in terms of what our root reaction or motivation is. But, yeah, I do think dogs will respond to people, especially people who are aware of how to or how they're being perceived by the dog. Like, are they taking action that... ensures that the dog doesn't view them as a threat, you know, so are they getting down at the level of the dog, and is it their tone of voice, and I think they will respond more to people who are doing that, and in a way, you can think of it as that human is making the extra effort to communicate at that sort of dog level, not saying that it's a lower level, but it's almost like a nonverbal kind of communication going on. Yeah. Great. Any other questions?
Is there any way you can expand on epigenetic the epigenetics?
Expand on epigenetics, yes. One of my favorite things to talk about right now. Yeah, it's... So let me give you guys a little bit more background about it. So Michael Meany and colleagues at McGill, of course, they were very interested in looking at maternal behavior, and they were doing these behavioral studies where they were taking these female rats, and some female rats were quote-unquote good mothers, did lots of licking of their pups, and some mother rats didn't lick as much. And so what they did was they wanted to know if that was genetic or environmental. So that was the original experiment. And so what they did was they cross-fostered the pups. So they took the pups from one litter and gave them to the dam that didn't lick as much, and then they took the pups from the litter that didn't get licked as much and to the mom that does lick the pups a lot, so just to make it confusing. So they cross-fostered them so that they could account for how much of this is environment versus how much is this genetic. And what they found was an interesting interaction, because initially it proved to be environmental. So it depended on the mothering experience that you had, that would be what you passed on to your offspring. But what was interesting about that too is that the offspring then of that adopted litter, I'm hoping I'm getting this right, would persist for generations. So that had changed the genetic expression of maternal behavior. That environmental change of cross-fostering the pups not only changed the pups' behavior, but then that was continued on for generations afterwards. So there are a lot of other, it's not just strictly behavioral phenomena that we've been interested in epigenetics for. There's been a lot of things actually on social media where the headline is like, you inherit your grandmother's fears, things like that. So that comes from a study where they did contextual fear conditioning. So that is, there's some stressful situation that gets associated to a context in the laboratory. And then they looked at preference for that context in the grand pups of the laboratory animals that experienced the original association, and they would enter that context significantly less often, is how I'll word it, than control. So it was sort of ingrained in there. It didn't change the actual genes, but just the pattern of expression changed, and it was related to cells in an area of the brain called the hippocampus. But one that's also received a lot of attention is the agouti gene. And that's one I always talk about in some of my introductory classes, because it is where there's this link to BPA exposure, right? The bad thing in plastics. And so BPA exposure and during pregnancy can alter the expression of this agouti gene, and depending on the expression of that gene will determine things like the color of a mouse's coat, the extent of the adipose tissue or the fat tissue of the mouse, and that has to do with a chemical exposure that happened while they were developing in utero. So yeah, really interesting stuff, because it's really a question about how the environment is programming us to be, in a way, more adapted, but accounts for all of these differences that we're now beginning to be able to study in the lab. Yeah. So, I think maybe 5 minutes is good. Come on in. Okay, if there's no more questions, I think I'll leave it there, and then we'll get to watch Mr. Fantastic Fox. I haven't seen this movie in forever.
Thank you for your
talks. Thank you.